So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned that before the end of times, Allah azza wa jal will start taking away the lives of pious people. Righteous and pious scholars and ulama will begin to pass away. He mentioned, يَذْهَبُ الصَّالِحُونَ الْأَوَّلُ فَالْأَوَّلُ وَيَبْقَى حُفَالَ كَحُفَالَةِ الشَّعِيرِ أَوِ التَّمَرُ لَا يُبَالِيهُمُ اللَّهُ بَالَةً. That Allah Azza wa Jal will take away the righteous, pious people. Pious people will start leaving the world and dying. Al-awwal fal-awwal, one after another, the best, thumma the best, then after that, the best. One by one, until you see the righteous people will no longer be with you. And then what will be left behind is a leftover garbage. He mentioned a hufala, which is basically the leftover raddi, useless fruit, or useless dates, useless barley or wheat, that is left at the end of the day by a seller. Even he puts it 50% off, people don't want it. You see that in the grocery stores here. When you go, after the sale is over or the sale is coming to an end, people bought and bought. You have the leftover berries that have all become green and moldy. The strawberries that no one wants smashed up. Oranges that have really been, yani, their color has changed and are right about to rot. Everyone has hand chosen and picked. And what remains is the useless thing that they're going to throw away now because no one wants it. That's the hufala. The leftover stuff at the bottom of the batch that no one wants. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that that's what's going to be left over from the people. The good stuff is all going to be gone. And since Allah Azza wa Jal, He values people, He puts the price tag on people, not from the region they come from, that are they from this geographical background, do they belong to this type of family or tribal system or a tribe, but instead Allah Azza wa Jal puts the value and the price tag on people based on the qualities they have. So these people, they will have absolutely no good qualities within them. So He says, لا يبالي لهم بالا, Allah Azza wa Jal will not give them any attention, will not value them. Because they have nothing to give to Allah. They have nothing inside them that impresses Allah Azza wa Jal. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he mentioned something similar. He says, يَذْهَبُ الصَّالِحُونَ أَسْلَافًا, that the pious people are going to go away. This hadith that I mentioned was in Bukhari, and this hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, this athar is from Tabrani fi Mu'jam al-Kabir. He mentions that the pious people will go away one after another. وَيَبْقَى أَهْلُ الرَّيْبِ مَنْ لَا يَعْرِفُ مَنْ مَعْرُوفَ وَلَا يُنْكِرُ مُنْكَرًا. After the pious people are gone, only the people of doubt will remain. The people who doubt everything. Ahlul Rayb. The people who doubt, and they will be suffering from this disease of speculative skepticism, by which it will not allow them to recognize anything good as good, or regard anything wrong as wrong. Everything will be subjective. Every single thing will be subjective. There will be no absolute truths. There will be no basic line which we don't cross. There will be no such thing as, this is the limit to how much we are going to change our ways. This is the limit of how much we are going to water down our faith. This is the limit of how much we're willing to compromise. There will be no line. It will be a moving target, to an extent that nothing will remain from what we call the thawabit. Thawabit are those parts of the religion that don't change, that are set in stone no matter what part of the world you are, no matter what region, no matter what century. Those things that never change are the thawabit, that you have no difference of opinion between two Muslims about. Those thawabit also will go away. Ma'ruf will become munkar, munkar will become ma'ruf. Not only people will be so full of doubt that they won't be able to recognize good as good and bad as bad, but rather other hadith mention that they will begin to regard good as evil and evil as good. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that not only will people, Abdullah Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says, not only these people of doubt won't be able to recognize anything good as good and evil as evil, but in another narration, although the chain of narration is weak, but the meaning, you tell me yourself, this is one of the miracles, that subhanAllah, the chain of, if a hadith is chain of narration, does not mean it's weak, does not mean it doesn't exist. The Prophet ﷺ is reported to have been told as Sahaba, and there's different narrations of that. Imam Ghazali rahimahullah mentioned this in his Ihya as well. and other scholars have mentioned it, where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam addressed his Sahaba. And he said, كيف أنتم? In one hadith, كيف بكم? What will happen to you? He said, كيف بكم إذ لم ت... In one hadith, he said, كيف بكم إذا طغى نساؤكم وفسق شبانكم وتركتم جهادكم? Three things. What's going to happen to you? What will be your situation on that day when three characteristics will become salient amongst you? Number one, طغى نساؤكم, your women will cross all boundaries and will become openly belligerent against Allah Azza wa Jal. They will, طغى, he recited today, إِنَّا لَمَّا طَغَى الْمَاءُ حَمَلْنَاكُمْ فِي الْجَارِيَةِ. When the water will go above the limit, you have a sea level, you have a limit at beyond which, if it goes, if the water level of the sea rises above that, you have a flood. طغى, طغى الماء is when the water goes above a certain limit that is acceptable, that won't cause damage. Allah Azza wa Jal says, إِنَّا لَمَّا طَغَى الْمَاءُ, that the water level just went up, shot up due to the rain at the time of the tufan of Nuh alayhi salam. So tagha is when you cross that boundary after which it's a hell breaks loose. It's a tsunami. Rasulullah says, tagha nisa'ukum. Your women will break that boundary. Your women will break that boundary. وَفَسَقَ شُبَّانُكُمْ, your youth, your youngsters will become open sinners without shame, without fear. That social media will be an outlet, for example, to shamelessly express a person's life of sin and vice in front of the world. That sin which was done covertly, people will gloat over it, over those sins on social media, without any fear of repercussion. This is what we call the mujahir, who Allah hates and will not forgive unless they seek genuine forgiveness from this. Is the one who's committed a sin and Allah could have exposed that person while he or she committed that sin, but Allah, out of His love for that person, covered him up. But in the morning, this person himself, out of the audacity, uncovers his faults in front of the entire world. These are the mujahirun, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes, because they are openly telling Allah Azza wa Jal, here I am, do what you're going to do about it. Do what you want to do about it. I openly disobey you in your face, as we say. Mujahid, who use social media today to express their sins, to expose their sins. So Rasulullah said, فَسَقَ شُبَّانُكُمْ, your youth will become open sinners. And third, وَتَرَكْتُمْ جِهَادَكُمْ, and you as a collectively as an ummah will stop struggling and striving for the deen. People will struggle and strive for jobs and education. But when it comes for generally deen itself, people will start asking for the fatwa. Is that permissible? Is this okay? Isn't this too much? Isn't this too hardcore? Etc. etc. But no one will ask the fatwa. Ya akhi, you've been out of the house for the past 12 hours, working away, making money for the past, you know, 10 years. And look at your wife. You haven't given her attention. Look at your kids. They're at the mercy of the iPhone and the iPad because you're not at home. No one will go say, where's the fatwa permissibility of this? To leave your sons and daughters unattended at home every single day. You leave in the morning and they're sleeping. You come back at night and they're sleeping. The only time you hear from them is when they need money. But no one asks, where's the fatwa for the permissibility of this? They say, no, we have to. But if a person were to make a sacrifice for deen, all of a sudden the entire community starts pitying them, starts showing sympathy. Poor wife, poor children, poor person, he's lost his mind. As collectively as an ummah, people will leave sacrifice and struggle for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. So the Sahaba, when they heard these three things, it shocked them. They couldn't believe that the women will become like this. They couldn't believe that their youth will become like this. And they couldn't believe that that ummah that was established on sacrifice would collectively leave sacrifice for the greater good. So they said, أَوَكَائِنٌ ذَلِكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, is that seriously possible? Is that really going to happen, Ya Nabi Allah? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith mentions, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ وَأَشَدُّ مِنْهُ سَيَكُونَ, I swear, I take an oath in the, on that being in whose hands lies my life, worse than this will happen. Worse than this will happen. So they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, what could be worse than this? So he said, كَيْفَ بِكُمْ إِذْ لَمْ تَأْمُرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَمْ تَنْهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ,
What will happen when you will stop encouraging people to do good and you will stop prohibiting each other from doing evil? Now that again was a concept that was foreign.